My name is Alan Kramer, and I graduated in 1964.
Okay. And you mentioned that you had a story that you wanted to tell, so why don't
Yes, my father had also graduated from the law school, and it was a very interesting story. He graduated from Harvard College and was a very good student there, and went on to the Harvard Business School for a year. And then he realized he had graduated in 1929. It was the Depression, and he realized that people who were graduating from Harvard's Business School were busy selling apples. And he decided that going to the second year of business school didn't make much sense. So he was from Norwich, Connecticut, which is where I was born as well. And he went back to Norwich and managed to get a job at Norwich Free Academy, which is a private school that the town uses as the high school. And he taught there for a couple of years and then decided that he wanted to go to law school. So he applied to the University of Connecticut Law School, which was still in Hartford, and he was teaching in Norwich, and three times a week he had to drive up for classes after teaching all day, and the route coming from Norwich to Hartford at those days was not exactly terrific. It would take him about an hour and a half minimum to get up to the law school, where, by the way, Professor Starr was one of his professors. Mm-hmm. And he talked another teacher to join him in going to law school so they could alternate the driving, which they did. But anyway, he did this, and how he was able to teach a full day and then drive up here, go to classes three times a week, and then drive back, and then to do homework and other things, I don't know, but my father was very focused and very good in terms of dealing with situations. And he graduated as valedictorian of his law school class. And he went back to Norwich and got a job working for the first woman who ever got elected to Congress. Actually, she was running for Congress. She would have been the first woman ever to be a congressperson from Connecticut. And he became, as well as practicing law, he became her area representative, and did that for a number of years. And then one day, a gentleman from a nearby town came to him and said that he wanted to get involved in politics. He was busy selling used cars at the point. His name was John Dempsey, and my father got him involved in politics by virtue of giving him certain assignments that the congresswoman who did get elected had available. And he did it for a couple of years together with selling used cars. And then he decided to run for mayor of Putnam, I believe, and got elected mayor of Putnam, and did it for a couple of terms. And there was a Democratic convention, and they were looking for lieutenant governor. And they always balanced it with whatever nationality the person at the top was. They always had someone of a different nationality for the other positions. And they were looking for an Irish candidate, John Dempsey, who everybody called Jack, had this incredible memory to remember anybody he'd ever met 20 years ago. Not only would he remember their names, he would also remember their children's names and their wives' names, which in politics is a very good thing to have. Make a long story short, he ends up getting the lieutenant governorship and served for a couple of terms under Abe Ribicoff. And one day my father, who at that time had started a law firm in Norwich and was also the prosecutor in Norwich. At that time, prosecutor jobs were part-time jobs. I was getting ready to go on to law school, and he asked me point blank whether when I graduated I wanted to go back to Norwich, and I said I doubted it. I'd gotten married, and my wife wasn't too thrilled at the prospect. She was from the New York area, and too thrilled to living in Norwich, Connecticut. So my father decided that by virtue of the fact that he practiced for a number of years, they were getting ready to add a bunch of judges to the court system. And he decided that he would be, in fact, several people suggested to him that he would be a wonderful candidate for a judgeship if he wanted it. And since I wasn't planning to come back to practice, that probably sounded good to him. And so he put his name in, and my uncle was the editor of the Norwich paper, editor-in-chief of the Norwich paper, and he kind of became involved in my father's attempt to become a judge. My father's name got put forward together with a lot of other names. And there was a reporter on the Hartford Courant who used to play golf with Governor Ribicoff all the time. And as a result, he always had inside information. And the day before the judges were to be announced, he published the list of names of all the judges. Ribicoff was going to appoint. And my father got all these phone calls and congratulating him. And the next day, the list was announced, and the list was correct except for one name. My father's name was no longer on the list, and they had substituted another Irish person from New Haven, who was involved, very much involved in New Haven politics. And my uncle, who was an editor of the paper, obviously was able to get access as to what exactly had happened. And what had happened was that there was this New Haven political leader who said that he wanted this guy to make a judgeship, and you better get rid of somebody on that list. And my father got selected, and the reason that it appeared he got bumped was that there was complaints that too many Jews had been named by Ribicoff, who was Jewish himself. And the suggestion apparently politically was this is not a smart move, even though all of the people who were named were pretty competent people. My father was an aces kind of guy. And the next day my father got a phone call from Jack Dempsey, and he said, look, he said, I'm sorry about that happened. I've known you, and I pleaded with them to just, you know, you're a spectacular person, and you really should be named. But he says, Ribicoff is not gonna stay as governor too much longer, and I'm gonna be the next governor. And I will tell you right now that if I get to be governor, the first appointment I'm gonna make is you. Well, within something like 3 weeks, one of the United States senators died, and Ribicoff named himself to be the senator. Dempsey moved up to become the governor. And a week or two later, some judge died. And Dempsey called my father immediately, and he said, congratulations, Judge Kramer. And my father became a judge. Served on the Superior Court for quite a lengthy time, and everybody I know who dealt with him said he was a terrific judge because, first of all, he was very smart, very fair. He, by the way, had stayed quite close to the law school because Starr was here for quite a while, and he had become friendly with Starr since he was a Starr pupil. You know, and I meant Starr, not only Starr, but he was an Starr pupil as well. And he had great affection for Judge Starr, Professor Starr, and for the law school. And when I decided to go to law school, I went to the University of Pennsylvania, and I'd graduated cum laude, and I applied to three law schools. I applied to University of Pennsylvania Law School, Cornell Law School, and University of Connecticut Law School. And decided that going to the University of Pennsylvania Law School, which was actually next door to my fraternity house at Penn, would not be a smart move because I'd be hanging out at my fraternity house and at some point you should move forward. And so I decided I was going to go to Cornell Law School, and my wife and I went up to Cornell Law School, which I had never really seen, but had a good reputation, and we got up there and it was just terrible weather, I mean, which it is up there a lot. And my wife said, "Do you really want to be up here for law school?" And I said, "Well, I'm no fan of bad weather either, and the University of Connecticut is a good place, you know, academically, and you know, I'd really like to maybe go there." And I came up to the law school, and my wife managed to get a job at the Renbrook School in West Hartford. And we had a very nice experience going to law school. I had a wonderful group of people in my class. The professors were really quite spectacular. And when I graduated, I decided I wanted to go to Washington and get a job in Washington. And I applied to several places. I was offered a bunch of jobs. One of the jobs I was offered was as a legal advisor to one of the cabinet secretaries, the Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare. And it was a guy by the name of John Gardner, who had been the president of Common Cause and just a spectacular guy. And I decided that, you know, that would be a terrific thing to do. Well, so I go down there and was there. Johnson was the president at the time because he replaced Kennedy. And at that time, the Kennedy investigation was going on. There was all kinds of charges that maybe there were more people who should have been arrested, etc. It ended up with a lot of investigation going on, and there was a very elaborate book done on the report on the Kennedy Commission. It was chaired by the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court to do the investigation. Because I was working for a cabinet secretary, I had gotten to know a lot of people and managed to get several copies of the report. And a friend of mine was a clerk for the Chief Justice, and I got him to autograph the several copies. And I remember I sent one of the copies to a professor here by the name of Craig Shea, who was my favorite. And he was extremely appreciative, needless to say, because this was a very monumental book. And over the years, I've tried to keep my connection with the law school. The prior dean to the present dean actually became quite a close friend, and he and his wife became good friends. And I really enjoy dealing with them, and, you know, so I've had nothing but wonderful situations at the law school, and I've been very appreciative of it.